Electric Department of English. It gives me immense warmth and great pleasure to grace all of your presence in the interest of entire department. It gives me tremendous presenting the welcome among esteemed personality. Before we begin the session, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to all of you who sincerely committed to this session to make it a success. This session would have been impossible without the support of each and everyone present here. Online lecture series are organized and conducted for us, for the students, to gain insight and information that would remain effective in our studies, our life and work. Each topic discussion for today's session was chosen, keeping in mind the interest of us, the students, and I ensure the session will be profitable and fruitful for all of us. Now, I would like to request Sutapa Pradhan, fifth semester, to introduce our guest speaker of today's session. Thank you.
Again, a very good morning to each and everyone. Thank you all for your highly participation. On behalf of the Institute Shahid Matangini Hajra Government College for Women, I cordially welcome our guest teacher, Madhu Srivastav. She is an assistant professor of English with more than 10 years of teaching experience at the UG level as well as PG level. She has many academic publications to her credit in Journal of Repute. She has successfully completed an interdisciplinary minor research project on women empowerment as depicted in the novels of Manju Kapoor. She also has dabbled in theatre and written very short plays and trained her students to perform snippets of Macbeth and Shakuntala on stage. Her areas of interest are women's writings in fiction, non-fiction, and poetry. Besides, she is also a creative writer and translator. She has translated both poetry and prose and published her translations. She is also a passionate poet with numerous publications in national and international journals, and also has a book of poetry named Trips Climb Circles, which has been well reviewed. Now I'd like to request Ankita Chatterjee to take on. Over to you, Ankita. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Sutapa. Thank you so much. We're going our beloved professor from her mouth. We want to hear the noble Amar Jibon by Raj Sundari Devi and our wretched life. This noble is very grateful, but from our beloved professor, we want to be more rich with her explanation and with her observation on these nobles. So invite professor, from her mouth, we want to hear the novels Amar Jibon. We while very grateful to hear this novel, our new professor, please give our some information about Amar Jibon by Raj Sundari Devi. Have a good day, everybody.
Thank you. Should I begin now?
Okay. Yes, Madhu.
Yeah, thank you, students. I'm really amazed to see your level of participation on a Sunday morning. So, without further delay, yeah, I'll be speaking on two autobiographies, that is non-fiction, by Indian women who are more or less two centuries apart. One is Rashudhari Devi and the other is Baby Kamli's autobiographies. So the topic of my deliberation today is Reflections of the Age and Agency in Autobiographies by Indian Women. Now, what is an autobiography? An autobiography, as we all know, is a literature of personal revelation, and its main interest lies in the conscious or unconscious self-portrayal by the author. The author must not give just an account of her external life, but of her internal life, her ideas and emotions that float through her conscious and unconscious self. And this requires talent because it needs the author needs to have artistic self-control in ordering the material and also control over the language. Now, as we know, writing was a forbidden domain for women. So Indian women's autobiography also appeared only in the 19th century. Now, as a genre, autobiography has been used by women writers to give expression to the development and expression of the self, as they have remained invisible for centuries. Now, the invisibility of the subject does not mean non-existence of the individual, but it implies the need of the subject to be expressed, explored, known, and told. In the postmodern and postcolonial era, not only feminists, but also literary and cultural theorists have felt the need to recognize women's autobiography as a genre. Making visible the former invisible subject is the task now adopted by many theorists. So, but writing autobiography or presenting the self was always difficult for women because, as we know, within patriarchy, women are represented as patriarchy wants them to represent. Because of the socio-cultural constraints, women found difficulty doing it. But nevertheless, as we will see through the course of the talk, that they did it very successfully, even way back in the 19th century, which is said to be the first autobiography written by a woman. So, literature records the changing realities of life, and women's autobiographies of self-representation are also records of their, not only of their personal histories, but also of the times. That's what the topic says, and that's what I'll talk about, along with their personal histories. And women's autobiographies defied the set norms of language and aesthetics and molded them to speak of lives that have broken out of the ordinary. As Helen Cixous, French feminist, says, the invisible domain of women's writing as elsewhere, in her essay, Stories Out and Out, she argues, it is time to change, to invent the other story. This elsewhere that French feminist Cixous discusses is what women writers and critics of autobiography have struggled to find and record. This elsewhere includes women in literature and history. In fact, it is where women rewrite his story and each one tells her story or the other side of the story. We are going to make a study of two autobiographies by Indian women authors, one from the 19th century and one from the 21st century, more or less of our own times. And these autobiographies will show how these women use their agency as an act of resistance, which they use to express through their writings. Now, I'll skip a few, slides to meet the time. But never mind, my talk will be comprehensive. So I'm going to talk about two autobiographies, like I said. I just want to focus on the time here. 1876, Amar Jibon or My Life was published. It is the life story of a high caste Hindu woman belonging to a family with land and property. And the other one of our discussion is Jina Amucha or The Prisons We Broke by Bibi Kamle, autobiography of a Dalit woman. So these two stories are lives of women who are both marginalized and oppressed by the patriarchal setup, but their social position and caste identity unveils before the reader two different worlds. Set apart by centuries, it presents before the reader how the change, the lot of women has not changed much, though there is hope. So this is the cover of the book by Rashchandri Devi. You can see it in Bangla, it's Rashchandri Dashi. There's a story behind that, maybe some other time. So this Rashchandri's time frame is 1809 to 1899. Now, how there are different ways you can approach the book. One is just you take up the book as a novel and you read it, just you get what the author says, but that will not do justice to the book. As students of literature, as Sonika Sarkar says, we need to read between the lines and try to understand a lot that Rashchandri omits, which needs to be considered to understand her life as part of the religious and social life of the 19th century colonial Bengal, to which she doesn't refer to. Now, I'll talk about two persons of her own times who made observations about the book. Both are male. One is Jyotindranath Tagore, 1849 to 1925. He was a playwright, musician, editor, painter, the elder brother of Rabindranath Tagore. So you can understand he was a stalwart and he was given this copy of Amar Jibon. And this is what he says. Very briefly, I'm going to say, this writing is by a woman, an elderly, mature woman of 88. I therefore read this piece with great curiosity, which I found well written and significant. Actually, the events of her life are so wonderful and her style has such a natural simplicity and charm that it is difficult to put the book down. The writer is an ideal woman. She is adept at housework and she is religious and God-loving. Now note this line, because you'll find a lot of contradictions to it. He points that her religious values were inscribed early on by her mother. Right at her childhood, her mother told her, if you're afraid of anything, you think of Dayamadu, who was a family deity. And he talks of it because at those times, you know, a lot of fuss was made about religious reading the scriptures, which are all very important in the reading of the text. And another point he makes, which is important for our study, is that her desire to educate herself. Another stalwart of the times was Dinesh Chandra Sen. He was a Bengali writer, educationist, and researcher of Bengali folklore. And he was also the founder of the Ramtanu Lahiri Research Fellow of the Department of Bengali Language and Literature of the University of Calcutta. He read the book and he said that Rashundari's life is a factual document of the life of an old Hindu woman. He says she's actually recording the social scene without being aware of it. That is so. He says there is no a second copy of literature in Bengali, like the kind of Rashundari's book, which situates women's position so exactly and frankly. He stresses the importance of the historical and social significance of the book, as her story is the only text that enables us to understand the life of a woman of her times. And he is, represented by women, the way women feel, because there were men writing about women all the time. And how are they writing about her? Merely as a love object. And so he says, she has started from where poets and novelists leave off. I wonder if any male writer, however talented, could have alluded to the depths of a woman's heart the way she has done. Now, this book is of utmost importance, as now you have understood. So it was parts of it, excerpts of it, were translated and included in the book, which is called The Bible of Women's Writing in India, Women Writing in India, 6000 BC to the present, by edited and compiled by Shashi Tharoor and K. Lalita. And Inakshi Chatterjee was called upon to translate the book. And Inakshi Chatterjee also says in the acknowledgments that it is an important book because it is the first autobiography to be written in the Bengali language. And it was only after two decades that the next one by Rabindranath Tagore was published. So we can say it's not only the first autobiography by an Indian woman, but also by an Indian man of that century. This is in Bengali. This is the only writing by any women of these times, and hence it serves as a document of historical significance. It tells us about the status of women in the 19th century Indian society in the words of a woman. And it was written at a time when women were not educated, but there was talk of women's education and some women were being educated privately. This is the structure of the book. There are two sections, part one and part two. You have excerpts from the first part, which was translated when she was at the age of 59 and published in 1876. And the second, it consists of 16 compositions. And the second part was written when she was 88. And then she also revised the first part in 1906. And I'll just focus for the sake of the students, mainly on the portions which you have in your syllabus. That is, the third composition is about her early marriage at 12. And she speaks of the unbearable pain of separation. Only God accompanies her to her natal in-law's house. The fourth composition is about her journey from her home to her in-law's place and where she's imprisoned for life. The fifth composition is an account of her domestic life and drudgery, the struggles of balancing motherhood and daily chores at the cost of herself. And the sixth composition is an account of her desire and obsession to read, to learn to read against all odds, unimaginable and commendable, and makes one wonder why she took such a lot of pain. And she says it in her own words, to read the Chaitanya Bhagavata. Rashundari was born in 1809 in Potajia village in Pabna district in a landowning family. Uneventful, unremarkable life. She was an extremely timid child. And right from her childhood, she had this fear of child lifters who would kidnap her if she argued with elders, if she fought with her playmates. So she was, this is again very strong patriarchal move, but this fear, took her over. And she became so timid that everyone bullied her. And then the elders in her family, she did not have a father. She lost her father at 4. The elders in the family, they decided that she could not be kept in the inner quarters. and to play with girls. So she was kept in the outer quarter, that is in the school, which was in the outer house, where all the boys of the village came to study, and an English lady would come to teach. And she was made to school in the made to sit in the schoolroom beside the teacher when she was 8 years old. And at that time also, she was quite aware of her good looks, because she writes about the comments of others. People used to call me a golden doll. Look at the word doll. She didn't talk to anybody and sat quietly in the schoolroom. The boys used to write the 34 letters of the alphabet on the floor and read them loudly. Now, this is actually how she learned the letters by herself, though no one was aware of it. She was very close to her mother, who taught her to pray, to rely on God. And at 12, she was married off to Sitanath Shikdar, a prosperous landlord from the Ramadiya village at Faridpur. She had no idea of marriage like the other girls of her age. She was very scared. And then at the moment of separation, she was inconsolable. And then she asked her mother, "Are you sure that God will go with me?" Because that is what her mother told her, that don't worry, God will go with her. She is all alone, going to another, to live with a family of strangers. She has nothing to do. She accepts her fate. But her description of her state speaks volumes of the mental agony of the little girls of her period, of those times when, you know, all girls were married so young. And this is the trauma they went through, which no other writing records it the way Rashtrakuti records. "With great effort, they took me away from my mother. It is indeed a sad thing to leave one's parents and settle in some other place and live under other people. With none of my near ones close by, I sank into deep depression. Since there was no way out, I started praying, 'Please be with me, God.'" And then the imagery she uses, it was very much like the sacrificial goat being dragged to the altar. The same hopeless situation, the same agonized screams. She traveled by boat, which was a new experience for her, and it made her feel sick. She was very miserable. And then again, all that she can do is she's crying and she's praying to God, and she's saying about herself, "I felt like the caged bird, the fish caught in the net." And you have to understand that at the age of 59, she's sitting and recalling her days of 12 when she was separated from her family. And it was so deeply entrenched in her mind, the pain, that you know, she can bring out that emotion even when we are reading now. So as the boat is about to reach, you know, the other side, and they talk of that we have reached home, then she feels confused. Who's home? She, women are actually displaced for life after marriage. And so her autobiography is a series of trials that she survived due to God's grace, and the greatest ordeal for her as a married woman. As a married woman, leaving the law, the natal home, and settling in the law's place, she again uses the image of grafting. Grafting was very painful, and this is what other women's writing of the age also speaks about. We have Hindu Mohila Gane Durabustha by Kailash Vashini Devi. She describes the ways, and you know, her movements were regulated as a new bride, what she has to do, what she does not have to do. As a pious Orthodox Hindu family governed by Brahmanical injunctions and untouched by Western reformist ideals. 19th century was a time of great change. Reformists were working out new ideas on new patriarchy was being formed in the context of nationalism, if you think, because the colonizers were, you know, putting our men down, that you are uncivilized, you are not good enough, your women are locked indoors. What? How can you even think of, you know, becoming independent? You are not good enough. And so what did the colonizers do? I mean, the colonized, the nationalists, they tried to put up our spirituality as a token of their superiority to the colonizers, who in the public space were putting them down in all possible manners. So they tried to preserve the inner quarters, that is the home, where women were central. And they tried to make it untouched by Western ideas at all. And that is why a section of men were, you know, completely put off by the thought of education by women, for women, because they thought that the Western influence would come in and then women would also be polluted. And then this spirituality, so-called spirituality, this pure inner sphere, the private sphere, which they were trying to preserve and show off to the colonizers, would also not remain so pure. And so this idea of, there were very conflicting thoughts at that time. An icon was created of the good Hindu women with a simple dress, her conch shell bangles and red vermilion mark, her wholehearted surrender and self-immersion in the Shongshar, her endless bounty and nurture in cooking and feeding. Women's own writings from the 1860s, however, question the foundation of these icons. At 14, Rashunuri was looking after the entire household single-handedly. There were 25 servants, but none of them at that point worked in the inner quarters. On the contrary, she had to cook for them, including the family members. Her world was the kitchen, and now her cage had distinct spatial connotations. She was in charge of the many rituals for the family idol, had to nurse her blind mother-in-law, look after a stream of unexpected guests. As noted by Kanika Shorkar, Rashmiri's account of her daily work deconstructs the iconic figure of the contended female nurturer in two very crucial ways. She listed her service to the family idol as work and not as emotional release and aesthetic gratification that was meant for him. She gives a detailed account of a grueling work schedule, although thanking God all the time for a strong body which could bear the strain. Thus, she ruptures the image of the nurturer of emotional fulfillment and constructs the image of the slave. She made a similar move with the image of motherhood. Conventionally, motherhood was depicted as cherished, devotional, or patriotic icon of happy, self-effacing nature. But she restored the feel of slog to the image. She became a mother at 18 and had 12 children. And she went on bearing children roughly at 2 years interval till she was 41. And she writes about her struggles. God only knows what I had to go through during those 23 years. Nobody else had any idea either. If kitchen was a cage, so was the sexual body of a young woman. She stopped giving birth after her grandson was born, not because she became infertile, but that was the system. After that, they practiced abstinence. She says, I had to work right through the day and night without a moment's rest, so much so that I often did not eat either of the two meals. There were days when the pressure of work did not let me even have one meal during the course of the day. Rashunuri extended the same move with brilliant success to the theme of food, on cooking, feeding, eating, and non-eating. She gives graphic details of one of many such incidents when she had to go without food for 2 whole days. Because she had to continuously attend to either of her children, or if she wants to eat late night, her husband is resting, or the storm comes and blows off the lamp. And finally, when she settles down to eat, the child urinates on her food, which leaves, you know, no doubt about what kind of life even high caste married women had to live, with all restraints laughing it away to keep up appearances. She says, this was an act of God and it made me laugh. I did not tell anyone that I had been without food for the last 2 days. It was an embarrassing subject and I did not want others to discuss it. Now, 19th century, I said, was a time when a new patriarchy was being formed and a lot of behavior manuals were being written for women, what women should do, should not do, how they should, you know, look after their house, everything. But even these manuals like Kunnar Pruti Upadesh, they did not know what to say about on women and food. So one of them records, my child, if you serve yourself, you will be called shameless. If you wait for others to serve you, you may have to go without food. In the 19th century, femininity was tied up with professed indifference to food, to the habitual neglect of eating. The describing authorities who had created the image of Annapurna, goddess of food, and relegated women to a lifetime of non-eating in the middle of endless feeding had also fixed the terrifying counter image of Kali, the primal female force that devours creation itself. Rashunuri refuted the iconic privilege of Annapurna as she describes her acts of cooking and feeding as hard work. I had to cook quite a lot, about 12 seeds of rice each meal. She made no reference to the possibility of excitement of cooking, the aroma and taste of memorable dishes as she would have prepared as a successful housewife. On the contrary, she is quite clear about the deprivational aspect. She frankly and humorously talks about her senile greed for good food in old age, as if age had somehow defeminized her and liberated her from the prescribed inhibitions. Her trials as a mother makes her aware of her own duties towards her own mother, for whom she regretted not being able to do anything. She says, I know perfectly well the tortures a mother has to undergo because of her children. Every human being should know this. Most people do not have any knowledge about the matter. She was not allowed to visit her paternal family. She was allowed to visit her paternal family only on special occasions of 15 people accompanying her two senior men, two maid servants. But on her deathbed, when her mother expressed a last wish to visit, to see her, she was not allowed to go. And she regrets that throughout her life. She says, they never sent me to her because the household work here would suffer. It is my misfortune. It is a matter of no ordinary regret. Alas, my God, why did you let me be born a human being? Why was I ever born a woman? Shame on my life. She's very aware that had she been a boy, a man, this would not have been the case. If I was a son, I would have flown directly to my mother's bedside. But I'm helpless. I'm a caged bird. As the sixth composition elaborates on the desire to read and details how she went about the unfathomable task, she says, as for some time I wanted to read, but she's again angry with herself for wanting to read because that was not appreciated. People used to deprive women of learning, and older women used to show a great deal of displeasure if they saw even a piece of paper in the hands of a woman. Like I said, why there was opposition to learning, because of the, you know, clash between the nationalists and the reformists. And Rashtrakuti is belongs to those times, as is evident. And she says that she wanted to read the Chaitanya Bhagavat, the first Bengali biography of Chaitanya. Who was Chaitanya? As we all know, the Krishna maddening saint of medieval Bengal, who had promised salvation to the poor, the low caste, the women categories, excluded by the Brahmanical orthodoxy from higher spiritual learning. Now, her reading then had a lot to do with the lives of divine and saintly, with a covert design that hid behind the seeming unintentionality. Rashtrakuti was actually structuring her mundane life story on the sacred pattern. Each detail, however commonplace and homebound, was arranged to exemplify a godly intervention. The crowning proof of which was her apparently miraculous access to the written word. Her life was meant to be read as if it was enclosed within a divine purpose, as if the two lives of the divine and the devotee were intertwined within a single narrative frame, interanimating each other. Now, we have to understand that Rashtrakuti's urge to read and her reading of the Chaitanya Bhagavat and the other lives of Chaitanya and Krishna and a wide spectrum of other medieval texts and her reflections drew largely upon terms that belong to long and multiple lineages within Hindu religious discourses. And we need to study the book in the context of that. Now, Vaishnava Bhakti, or devotional discourses and practices that established a direct emotional connection between the Vishnu and his incarnation as Krishna and the devotee, seem to grant a large and free space to the women. The women is talking directly to God. Before that, it was not allowed. The great body of bhakti lyrics glorified the illicit love between Krishna and the gopis of Vrindavan, of whom Radha was of paramount importance. Chaitanya Bhakti generated an immense body of religious writing in Bengali and stimulated reading habits among sections of Vaishnav women and low-caste rural households. However, Vaishnavism had paradoxical perspectives on the matter of spiritual and textual knowledge. Now, Rashtrakuti's devotion and writing as a woman related to tradition in complex ways. As I said, low-caste Vaishnav women were reading, but Rashtrakuti belonged to a high-caste Hindu family. So she had to make crucial departures and breaks of her own within the bhakti tradition. She made a major innovation in religious as well as literary innovations by articulating a devotional statement through an autobiographical mode. As an upper caste Vaishnav woman, she must have listened to readings and practiced rites connected with these cults and texts, so she never speaks of them. She had read Chaitanya Bhagavat, Chaitanya Charitamrita, and drew much from both of them. She divided her writing into small sections dealing with specific themes and organized each section in a manner that covered whole phases of her life. She had access to a chaste literary vocabulary, a fast-flowing, vivid style. And she only needed the autobiographical mode to deal with the events of an ordinary human devotee, not the holy chronicle about wives and mothers of saints. Her closeness to God could only be proved by her own writing. It was at once a miracle in its manner and scope of achievement, as well as a record of God's intervention in her life. It was a miracle only she had witnessed, and so only her self-written life could testify. I quote, "One day I dreamt I was reading the Chaitanya Bhagavat. When I woke up, I felt enthralled. My life was blessed." She knew the book was at home, but as she couldn't read, How would she be able to recognize it? So she prays to God. Allow me to recognize the book. God heard her, and soon after, as she was working in the kitchen, she heard her husband say to her 8-year-old son, Bipin, I'm leaving my Chaitanya Bhagavat here. Please bring it over when I ask you to. Hearing these words, a delighted Rashtrakuti rushed to the spot, picked up the book. She tried to remember the illustrations on the handmade wooden frames of the handwritten book. Later, when the book was brought into the room, she secretly removed a page from it and hid it. It took some brainstorming to hide the sheet, as it had to be within her reach, but it had to be away from the view of others. She kept it in the khori in the kitchen. Now, her first ordeal after taking the page was to find time to read. There was no time to even look at it. In the evening, the work continued until late at night, and then there were the children, some demanding to go to the toilet, some were hungry, some were crying, some were sleeping. And as a Vaishnav Bhakt, she said all her personal things to God. So she says, please God, teach me how to read. If you don't, who else will? She worked out a way. I kept the sheet to myself. I kept the sheet in my left hand while I did the cooking and glanced at it through the sari, which was drawn over my face. But a mere glance was not enough. A determination to read made her steal one of the palm leaves of her son on which he had been practicing handwriting. One look at the leaf, another at the sheet. A comparison with the letters I already knew, and finally a verification with the speech of the others. That process I adopted for some time. This is something very unimaginable. It's very difficult. Again and again, her position as a woman made her aware of her humiliation on account of her gender. Though she feels angry, she refrains from putting the blame on her husband. Again, a very devout Hindu woman, she cannot blame her husband. She cannot openly say anything bad about him. She says it is difficult to ignore or reject accepted customs and practices. So that's why her husband didn't say anything about it, making her reader aware. But you know, her words, the sentences she uses, they can be read in many ways. She left a lot unsaid, but there are many possibilities of meaning. Like she says, it is difficult to ignore or reject accepted customs and practices. But what is she doing? She is doing something which is against convention, making us aware that if she can do it, others could also do it. And at that time, there were many women who were being helped at home to, you know, read. So she gives the indication that her husband also, if he wanted, maybe he could have helped her. But she says, what does she say? I have no reason to complain. God has looked after me well. Whatever he does is for the best. That's a, you know, acceptance is always there. But at some times, like in the case of her mother's death, she says, oh God, why was I born a human being? So it depends. She remembered the alphabet she had heard and learned it in her childhood, sitting in the classroom that helped her decipher the letters. So all through the day, she would be, you know, going through it. And after a great deal of time and with great effort, I somehow managed to stumble through the Chaitanya. Books were handwritten, and so reading was much more difficult. And with great effort, she learned to read. Now, what about writing? That was impossible in her situation because she says pen, paper, ink pot, so many things were required, and she had to write it, sit and write, and everybody would see. And she was a daughter-in-law. What would they say? So she didn't even attempt to learn writing. Now, she had three sisters-in-law who were widowed and who came to stay with her. Mother-in-law died. So her position is being consolidated in her family. She lessens the length of her pallav. She thanks God for her material resources, her children. And she gives a detailed account of her children, the changes she had in her body, and how she came to be considered of the older generation when she became a mother-in-law at 41. But she loses her name that she regrets. She was called Kotta Thakurun. And as days went by, we know that, she started reading, but she kept her ability to read a secret from her sisters-in-law, because she was not sure how they would, react. But later on, when she reveals to them that she can read, they are also delighted and they express a similar wish. And now she can freely read in front of them. She's reading in front of the maids, and she's also singing at times. And then she goes to read all the books in her house. Because they were rich, it was quite, you know, something to have a book. A handwritten book was quite costly. She had a lot of books in the house, and she read all of them. Jamini Bharat, Valmiki Puran, the first part of which the other parts were bought by her son for her in the print format, the Chaitanya Amrita 18 volumes. So you have to understand that before she sat down to write her autobiography, she was well read, well versed in the bhakti tradition. She goes on to count her blessings and then elaborates on a personal grief, which again, you know, testifies the problem of her times, child mortality. She gave birth to 12 children, of which only 5 survived. And she goes on to mention all of them who left her, and she also lost 2 grandchildren. Now, we know that she wrote it. So how did she learn writing? It was only when her 7th son, Kishorilal, said that, "Mother, we are not getting replies to our letters." They knew that her mother can read, but she is not replying. Then he bought all the paraphernalia, paper, ink, pen, pot to her and said that you give us replies. Again, another ordeal, another challenge. She says again, "How will I find the time?" That required much more effort. Then again, God intervened. Her husband was ill, and then they had to go to Krishnanagar and stay in her 5th son's place where he worked for some time. And then she says the housework was less, and in those 6 months, she taught herself to write. And then anyhow, so much of ordeals. She says the process of education was not easy at all. It seems as if God was my teacher, otherwise learning to read and write was impossible at the situation I was in. Still, as a bhakt, she feels she has not done enough. And part 2 of her autobiography, which I'll not speak about, is spiritual in nature, where she describes all her dreams and her talks with God. And she talks about God in all his avatars as the director of life's drama and the role playing of mere mortals. But here again, I will make only one point, that God is the creator of all life. But in this writing, this autobiography, she is actually recreating her own life the way she wants. Tanika Sarkar observes that Rajchundari chose to refer to Krishna as father and not as a lover or son, which is quite unusual. As a Bengali woman, both the roles of a mother or a beloved involved nurture, and she was tired of being the nurturer. On the contrary, she needed to create a source of stable nurture for herself within the realm of religious imagination, calling herself orphan at times and the daughter of a king, and then questioning his benevolence. She says that, "I am the daughter of a king, then how am I in this position, in this situation?" Then accepting his wish and her state. She says very little about her husband. In the 15 compositions, she describes him briefly, stating her inadequacy to do. And then she speaks of his virtues and powers, though he did nothing to help her. She was an obedient wife and afraid of him and grateful for what she had. She says nothing about her marital life, maybe owing to inhibitions of her times, or maybe because there was not much to say. And then when she became a widow, her head was shaved, as was the custom. She says, "I lost a crown of gold." That signifies the loss of social status. But her statement, "I do not regret what God had willed," makes one think if it is only stoicism, because there are accounts of widows leaving behind long loving accounts of the husbands. Now, Hindu marriage was valorized by the revivalist nationalists as a domain of affect, compensating for a miserable colonized existence in the public sphere. But Rajchundari's account makes us think understand that it was not good enough to be valorized, because the traumatic separation of the children from their parents' house meant an abrupt termination of childhood. Cohabitation was obligatory from the onset of puberty, often when the girl's body was immature for sexual penetration. There was no question of choice, of consent, of canceling the tie and shifting to another partner, however incompatible the marriage or whatever problems with the husband. Husband's polygamy or even his death would not dissolve the marriage bond. The sexually active years of women would also be the years of exacting labor, which could lead to dangerous and draining childbirths and also sometimes the birth of the woman. So her silence about her sexual life can be read as a turning away from her own sexuality, which was more of a trap for her. She describes the middle age, 40s onwards, which were free from sexual activity, presumably with affection and nostalgia. It was a time of relative power and privilege, a point where she emerged as a figure of considerable authority within the household. And then she uses the words "my shomsha" for the first time. Now, as a Vaishnava, Rajchundari used the pattern of transgression that was most familiar to her to describe her condition. She structured her desire to read on the mode of illicit love of Radha for Krishna. The conflict that tore her between her Shonshar Dharma and higher religious love turning her against it. She used expressions familiar to the literature of divine illicit love. Her household was against her desire. There was no one to help her. She had no tie for it. It split her very self. Yet she acknowledged its divine inspiration. It had taken hold of her entire being. I was forever yearning. By claiming that God had taught her to read, she took her place within the new domain of the great secular miracle tales of 19th century Bengal. She writes a lot about her dreams in part two, which can be read in this light. Now, as we find, it's a curiously self-absorbed narrative. Other people simply, you know, appear, make a point, and then they disappear. It is uncompromisingly non-dialogic. The husband only gets a separate section. She turned the narrative focus intensely and exclusively upon herself, first of all by abstracting herself from a concrete world. She says, I came to Bharatvarsha, and spent a long time here. This body of mine, this life itself has taken different forms. She lived in her life in two villages, in her mother's house till 12, and then in rest of her life in Faridpur, but they are nothing more than names. She gives no description of the landscape, of the people, of the festivals, of the, you know, a vibrant village life, nothing. And there is no local time, family time, village time. She gives herself a whole subcontinent and almost a century to live. So Rajchundari's life and writing stood at the confluence of two orders of patriarchy and of women's desires. On the one hand was a relationship with the bhakti tradition. It allowed the women seeking an access beyond a homebound existence, a certain ambiguous existence. On the other hand, there were times when a new system of liberal pedagogy came to include women as its target. It was, however, riven with doubts about its own agenda, that is the reformist agenda. Whichever way you may read it, Amar Jeevan was an autonomous endeavor that created its own world of meaning out of a whole range of given meanings. I leave a blank here because we are making a jump of two centuries from one book, 19th century, to the other, which is a Dalit autobiography by a woman Dalit. I'll begin just by explaining what is a Dalit, because, you know, actually these two books require two different lectures. Anyhow, a Dalit means crushed or crushed into a mass. Dalits, who were the Dalits? They belong to the lowest status in the hierarchy of the Varna or caste system. Till now, we had been talking about a woman who belonged to a high caste Hindu family. Now we'll be talking about the lowest rungs, women from the lowest rungs of society. And you can yourself, you know, see the difference. Though two centuries apart. A scheduled caste is the official term for Dalits as per the Constitution of India. They were formerly called untouchables, and they were excluded from the fourfold Varna system of Hinduism. They were considered impure, assigned to serve the caste groups above them. They were made to work as scavengers, cleaners, sweepers, leather workers, tailors, goldsmiths, blacksmiths, and fishermen. They were marginalized physically as well as socially. Compelled to live outside the village or its edge, they underwent brutal social oppressions as untouchables and were exploited for their labor. I'll not go into the Dalit movement, as that has been, you know, recreating Dalit history has been one of the agendas of Baby Kamle's book. Now, I'll talk about Dalit autobiography, which emerged as a genre during the 70s. The reason being the appearance of the educated class. Now, so the educated class is writing, and the Dalits were writing autobiographies as a true testament to raise their voice through the written word. The writers of the first generation wanted to depict their own experiences, revealing their own world, which was replete with marginalization and exploitation of all kinds. Dalits selected memoir through which they spontaneously expressed their feelings and experiences. This literature of the oppressed deals with poverty, hunger, disease, oppression, psychological turmoil, ostracism. Now, there's a difference between Dalit men's autobiographies and Dalit women's autobiographies. What is the difference? Dalit men's autobiographies do not talk about gender oppression in the way women's autobiographies talk about it, because they were writing, you know, to give the statement that Dalit lives are worthwhile. They were talking to, you know, establish the sacredness of their culture and things like that. But women, when they are writing, they are quite transparent about the oppression they face. The entire life narrative is based on the idea of communal identity, and the subjectivity in these autobiographies is complicated by the deep connection between the individual and the communal self. Now, Dalit women's autobiographies are heart-wrenching and authoritative portrayal of women characters that undergo adverse economical, social, educational, and cultural conditions prevailing in their days. And the women writers, they portray women as they see them around themselves and the way they were treated. And we have a, you know, large list of women's autobiographies. I'll read a few names and then go to the text. Like the kaleidoscopic story of my life in translation, Shanta Bai Kamble, Urmila Pawar's Aidan or Weave of My Life, Bibi Kai Kamble's Zina Mucha or Prisons We Broke, and Thoughtful Outburst by Kumud Pawade, Gu Shyamala's Father May Be an Elephant and Mother Only a Small Basket. And the list goes on. This is Bibi Kamble and her book, The Prisons We Broke. You have another translation, but I couldn't get a copy of it. So the thing is same. Bibi Kamble is among the first writers of autobiography among the Dalits. She kept her work hidden for 20 years from her husband and her family. Now, you just now heard about Rashchunduri, who learned on her own and kept her reading a secret. Now, this is Bibi Kamble, who kept her writing a secret for 20 years. Jina Mucha was translated by Professor Maya Pandit and published in 2008. And it records the position of Dalit women at the lowest rung of social hierarchy, subjected to inhuman living conditions, violence and discrimination that deprives them of opportunities, choices and freedom in all spheres of their life. It was first published as a Marathi text in 1986, redefined autobiographical writing in Marathi, not only in terms of form and narration, but also in the selfhood and subjectivities. And as we know, because it's in English, it was made available to a larger readership. In the introduction to the book, Maya Pandit writes about the Dalit movements and the flourishing of Dalit literature, thereby placing Kamble's autobiography in the tradition of self-assertion. She says that it went two steps ahead, more than self-assertion. What does it do? It was a head-on confrontation with Brahmanical hegemony on the one hand, and with patriarchal domination on the other. Maya Pandit classifies The Prisons We Broke as a socio-biography. This is a very important point, because like we say, read, Rashchunduri is only about herself. And here, it is hardly about Bibi Kamble. It's about her community. There are very few things she reveals about herself. And it all comes out at the end as a interview taken by Maya Pandit, which is published at the end of the book. All the questions which are usually, you know, answered in the autobiography, it is answered as an interview at the end of the book. Nevertheless, it redefined the tradition of autobiographical writing in Marathi in terms of form, narrative strategies, the experiential world, the selfhood and the subjectivities articulated. It was written with a deep-rooted urge to engage with the history of the Mahar community's deep-rooted oppression. The political edge of such a critical scrutiny obviously comes from the radical self-assertive politics of Baba, Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar, a major source of inspiration for Bibi Kamble, as he is for many radical and Dalit writers in Marathi. Most Dalit autobiographies are meant for mixed readership, for Dalit and non-Dalit, but Bibi Kamble is very clear that she is writing for her people. In the preface to the Marathi text, she asserts, "Today our young, educated and so-called progressive people are ashamed of using this word Mahar. But what is there to be ashamed of? It tells us that we are the great Mahars of this Maharashtra, the true original sons of this soil. Even the name Maharashtra derives from my name. And though you may feel awkward using this name, I do not. I love this word Mahar. It flows in my veins, in my blood, and it makes me aware to the core of my being of the tremendous struggle for food that we have waged." Bibi Kamble doesn't try to glorify the life of the Dalit community. Okay, I would like to make a point here. Dalit doesn't only mean the Mahars of Maharashtra. It, like I said in the beginning, it means all the people who are outside of the Varna system, the lowest. But here she uses the term Dalit, the word Meher, to mean Dalit community. But there are many other sub-communities. So she doesn't try to glorify the life of the Dalit community, nor is there any self-pity. She explicitly states that her intention is to subject the life of a community to critical scrutiny in order to demonstrate how Brahmanical domination had turned the Mehers into slaves, forcing them to live in conditions worse than animals. I quote, "My only intention in sharing this history with my children and grandchildren, my daughters and my daughters-in-law, is to show them what furnaces of suffering the true sons of the soil have come out of. The future generations must know this." The fire of emancipatory struggle characterizes this recasting of history. Memory becomes a device to inculcate the urge for resistance in future generations. It also serves the purpose of bringing to book the Hindu caste system as a perpetrator of heinous crimes against humanity. Now, in the course of the narrative, Kamble brings alive a world that is constituted by difference in location. The world is physically located on the margins of the village and also on the margins of the social imaginary. Because the things we are going to read in this book have never been discussed in mainstream literature. What we talk about is something else. So it is at once alienating and alienated by being cut off from the village as unclean, impure, polluting, and untouchable. Now the customs, rites, rituals, festivals, and jatras that Bibi Kamble describes are actually unexplored in literature. And so the sociologist Maxine Burston, to whom Bibi Kamble actually revealed for the first time that she has written her autobiography, she states in her introduction to Jina Amucha that above all, they expose the apparatus of Brahmanical dominance perpetrated through superstitions, literacy, ignorance, and oppressive practices. She speaks in a humane and mature tone to express her outrage against the inhuman conditions of existence. She exhibits a subtle sense of humor. Yes, there is a lot of humor, otherwise you won't be able to read the book. It is so traumatic, so revolting at times. It is unbelievable that this is the condition in which people have been living for generations and they have not even had the realization, leave behind, rebel, or do something. And then we'll see, you know, how when the people get the awareness, they are also resisting that change. That is quite human again. So she, with a lot of humor, she describes the rituals, ritual baths, unwashed children with dripping noses, full of snot, the games and the weddings. Another remarkable feature of the text is the transparency with which she brings out the internal trauma in the psyche of her people situated on the threshold of a fundamental transformation. Here I'm talking about the influence of Ambedkar. We all have heard of Ambedkar, I'm sure. He was quite instrumental in drafting our constitution. You know, he studied 60 constitutions before framing the draft of our constitution. And there, he was from a Dalit family. He was himself an untouchable in his own school. And then you can just Google and read about him. It is he who was instrumental in, you know, creating this awareness among the Dalits that what are they being subjected to? What is their reality? They are also human beings. They have every right to live a dignified life. And so when his influences are there, the Dalits are sending their children to schools, they are being educated. And there is a section among them only who is resisting this change. Because they believe that their situation has been ordained by God. So they are not going to do anything to change it. She gives an insider's view in describing their negotiations with this whirlwind of change, the contradictory impulses they had to confront, their bewilderment and doubts, their urge for self-assertion, the intense struggle between the pulls of an oppressive yet familiar way of life and the promise of a more dignified yet unfamiliar new world. Prisons We Broke brings to light the practices, like I said, which have not been described in literature. And it also foregrounds the transformative potential of oppressed people to change the world. Now, the book was originally published serially through Stree, a women's magazine. Like I said, she said that this book is for my next generations. And she begins with a little account of herself. Now, we are told that she was going to be buried alive. And she says that. Then she was finally not buried alive because her mother clung to her supposedly dead body throughout the night and cried. And in the morning, they found that the child is alive. Otherwise, she would have been buried alive and another cock was buried in her place. So she says that there is nothing to be ashamed of our past, that the people were so ignorant, you know. But this shameful state of being was forced upon them by a particular community, meaning the Brahmins. So she is stating their situation all the time, and then at the end of the chapter she is ruminating about the state, and she's saying that this state was brought upon them very politically by a particular section of society so that they could keep them in that situation and keep go on exploiting them. And now as education and as knowledge has seeped through them, thanks to Baba Ambedkar, whom she acknowledges again and again, now they can see through the ploys of religion, through the caste system. And she expresses a deep felt gratitude to Bhim, that is Dada Baba Sahib Bhim Rao Ambedkar. She says, great son of the soil, this son smashed the chains of slavery that bound us for millions of years. He taught a people who were compelled to live the ignoble life of animals to demand the right to live a dignified human life. He taught religion, which was standing on its head, to stand on its feet. O Bhim, you have been our great mother, and we will never be able to repay the enormous debt we owe you. We are eternally grateful to you. I am just a small flower that has bloomed in some obscure outskirts of a village. I offer this humble gift, my book, a tiny flower, at your feet. So Kamle's text is an important book, which offers an insight into understanding caste, community, identity, and its possibilities, the meanings of Ambedkar, Dalit movement, and Dalit identity. Kamle grew up in the Phule Ambedkarite movement when it was at its peak, and she was exposed to it right from her childhood. And she provides a graphic account of what the life of the Mahars used to be like, and before this influence was there, and how it changed due to Ambedkar's influence. And she says that it made her conscious about her caste identity, this movement. She learned to question the deprivation that the Dalits have not only endured for ages, but also regarded as their identity. In the first part, I said, she narrates the lives of the Dalits pre-Ambedkarite period, where they are poverty-stricken, accompanied by ignorance, superstitious, living in unhygienic environment. She describes the conditions of their lives living in the Maharwada. Their huts were nothing but stones arranged vertically with some mud coating. People covered in thick layers of dust and dirt, and their hair always untouched by oil, wearing tattered clothes somehow eked out in existence. When Hindu reformists worked for the abolition of untouchability, they attributed the cause of it in the unhygienic living of the untouchable, which made the Hindu repulsive of them. Sharmila Reji observes, the Hindu national discourse on caste viewed changes in diet and hygiene of the lower caste as crucial for the removal of untouchability. They overlooked the cause of untouchability. Kamle introspects the condition of the Mahars and the attitude of the Hindus. She strongly criticizes Hindu philosophy, which discarded them as garbage and exploited their labor. To get rid of the suffering, generations of the untouchables wasted their lives in senseless worship of stones. The gods they worshipped were not Lord Krishna or Ram, but smooth round stones representing Laman Pathan, Margi Mata, Yatal Sahib, etc. The status of Mahar among themselves was dependent on the rituals, number of gods, and the size of platform made of stone and mud for these gods. It shows that though the untouchables were considered Hindus, they were not only geographically alienated, but also culturally stood apart from Hindus. Along with lower social status, economic factor was equally responsible for the degrading condition of the untouchables, which Baby Kamle highlights through her autobiography. Now, they were deeply entrenched in superstitious beliefs and customs, so they took pride in offering their children to the god Kondiba. The eldest son was offered to the deity as Vagya or Potraj, and this Potraj would beg for alms from village to village, and the entire village would survive on this begging, and they felt blessed. Here I would like to make a point that she categorically writes about it, that they were not given any money as payment for all the work, all the hard, harshest work that they had to do. They were given leftover food and carcasses, that is the dead bodies of the animals, to eat. There was no system of payment for money. And this Potraj would collect all the leftover food and then come and distribute it among his people. She gives detailed descriptions of the house, belongings, and the dresses of the Mahars that is strikingly minimalist and speaks of their dire poverty. Children up to 9 years of age would look thin as sticks. When girls reach puberty, Their mothers would pull out some dirty rags from a bundle and put them on their bodies to somehow cover them. That was all by way of clothing. A rag would be tied around the waist, its ends pulled between its legs and tucked up at the waist. In her humorous style, Kamle describes how the Mahars would take pride in their superstitious beliefs and continue living in misery without any realization of their state or any attempt to improve their lives. She concludes the first chapter questioning this kind of living. What kind of life did these people really lead? What was there worth living for? Generation after generation wasted away in the senseless worship of stones in utter misery, perished. And in the next chapter, she elaborates on the traditional living of the Dalits, how even in the wretched nets, they had their own hopes and joys. She speaks of the month of Asar. If 11 months of the year were together, a horrible curse on the Mahars, Asar was an antidote. This would be only a tiny drop of happiness in a sea of suffering. And she speaks very satirically about God. She says that because the Mahars were very devout Hindus and they believed that God would change their lives. She says, if he had given a mouth, he also had to give a few morsels to feed it, to compensate for the fasting of the 11 months. And she speaks about, I said, like the potraj would get possessed by God and then he would play the drum and other women would also get possessed and there would be a lot of drama. And then she speaks about the buffalo, sacrifice by the Patil family. And after the sacrifice of the buffalo, the dead body of the buffalo would be given to them and then they would distribute the meat. And in the month of Asar, the women did all the cleaning. They went on cleaning the houses. I'll just go to that. Yeah, they cleaned the house, whatever there was. There wasn't much in the house, whatever it was. Their clothes, themselves, their own bodies, without soap. Only hot water, shikakai and stones used to scrub. How even the little girls would be involved in cleaning and would have fun killing the scores of lice that stuck to the saris of the women. She gives vivid descriptions of the unhealthy, unhygienic living conditions in which they lived. And they were not even aware of it. Even in the most wretched condition, Kamle's description brings out the strong community feeling and unity among them. They would look after each other, take note of what is happening. And she ruminates, Hindu philosophy had discarded us as dirt and thrown us into their garbage pits on the outskirts of the village. We lived in the filthiest conditions possible. Yet Hindu rites and rituals were dearest to our hearts. For our poor, helpless women, the haldi kumkum in their tiny boxes was more important than a mind full of jewels. So that is the whole irony of it, that they believed themselves to be Hindus, they did whatever the religion required them to do, yet they were in the most deplorable conditions because that was ordained by religion itself, and they believed it and they had no complaints. Kamle laments the simplicity of her people as they hoped against hope that their lives would improve someday and they would live like the upper caste. But when our bodies were considered worthless, who was going to spare a thought for our minds? The upper caste knew quite well that they would be able to control the Mahars only if they kept them on a tight leash. They were scared that if the hold was loosened even a little, the suppressed community would spring up in revolt and break the domination. Kamle goes on to describe the rituals of the Mahars in detail. Here I talked about the buffalo fair in the month of Asar. And so many details. She says the community had sunk deep in the mire of superstitions and the upper caste never allowed this lowly caste of ours to acquire knowledge. And so generation after generation perished in a superstitious way of life. And they had this custom where a newborn was born. It was believed that the goddess Satvai and god Barma had come to the house to write the fate on its forehead. She writes very ironically that they had made a common stamp. Because what was different from the fate of one Mahar to another? And she says that if they would get hold of those gods now, they would shake them. And this was a way of a simplified version of the theory of karma that prevented them to stake a claim against injustice done to them. It led the victim to adopt an attitude of resigned fate. Dr. Ambedkar had analyzed the theory of karma from the point of view of those who are educated to servility, seeks to manipulate the servile into acknowledging their wretched life condition as a part of the natural social arrangement. In this theory saps the rebellion of the untouchable in a systematic way. Like I said, they never had the urge to rebel or change their lives because they believed it was their destiny. So she writes how Ambedkar, what Ambedkar did to awaken their sense of dignity. Ambedkar started fortnightly Mook Nayak in 1920 and the Bahishkrit Bharat in 1927. This deeply stirred their lives, as the writer describes. All mehers would gather at a chowdi or public place in Maharwara, and the educated among them would read out the articles of Ambedkar. Then people would argue and debate over Ambedkar's thoughts. And there was the resistance to modern ideas and change. Kamli describes a few instances when a kharbari, that is a leader, opposed Ambedkar's call to give up their gods and educate their children to bring better days in their life as Christian ideas that was polluting their religion, as they believe their identity and work was inscribed by religion. There was also resistance in doing away with the Murali system when a Mahar girl was married to God Khandoba, like the Devdasis, and then she was exploited with religious sanction. Kamli in her story shows that those who were working in the cities understood the importance of Ambedkar's movement for emancipation of Dalits and worked for the mobilization of Dalits in villages. Ambedkar made an appeal to women, especially mothers, to come ahead and educate their children if they wanted any change in their lives. She writes how generation of mothers were truly instrumental in making sacrifices, starving to send their children to school, as at that point education was not free. Women also came ahead to spread the word of Ambedkar in meetings, to support him, follow him. Kamli narrates an incident in which a woman was instrumental in stopping the eating of carcasses condemned by Ambedkar in Birgaon. So there are many small incidents which actually speak for the general community. And she speaks how in 1938, the Mahar community chose 14th April, the birth anniversary of Ambedkar, to celebrate the new year instead of celebrating the Hindu festival of Gudi Padwa in Maharashtra. The festival celebrated by the Dalits is not merely ritualistic. It re-signified it by organizing a cultural program for the mobilization of the masses. The performance of Ambedkari Jalsa by the activists of the Dalit movement signifies that the Dalits created their own cultural life. Dalit activists borrowed their critical inputs from the Satya Sodhak Jalsa tradition of Mahatma Phule, who was a predecessor to Ambedkar. The writer's brother made preparations for Jalsa for the celebration of Ambedkar's birth anniversary. Kamli describes how the youth played a crucial role in breaking the age-old traditions at the call of Ambedkar. Like once Ambedkar wrote a letter, now the Dalit boys were being educated. They were living in a hostel. Kamli's brother and a future husband, they were all living in the same hostel. And he writes a letter that you go and touch the idol in the temple of your locality. And they make plans and they go and touch the idol. And then there is huge hue and cry. And animosity grows towards the Dalits and the Brahmins. They say that the idol has become impure, its face has become contorted, and then there are rituals to purify it. Kamli also describes her school days and the treatment the Dalit girls got from the teacher and the upper caste girls. They were made to sit in the corner of near the door from where they could not even see the blackboard. But what did they do? These girls were very, bold. They drank from the school tap, and now the others, they were in trouble as they couldn't drink from it. Some of the girls lamented that they had to go and take a bath at home because they were sitting with the Dalits in the same room. Now, she traces the history of the state of Dalit women from pre-Ambedkar days to her own times. And she says, even slaves had their slaves, and those were the daughter-in-laws. Now we see Raj Sundari was married at the age of 12, and here two centuries later, the Dalit girls, she notes, are also married at the age of 8 or 9 years old, and they are married to a life of violent patriarchal violence. She writes how her father, who educated her under the influence of Ambedkar, never allowed a mother to step out of the house. She uses images of bird in cage and bullocks, both used by Raj Sundari, and she says that they had to wear the pallav to cover their heads and faces, and greater the restrictions on women, greater the honor of the family. She says her parents never got on well because her mother was never allowed to go out, and she had complaints when there was no food for days and her father had no work. But her father, whenever he got the work, he spent the money on many things. He never saved, and when her mother complained, she got a sound thrashing. And she talks about the women's condition in general. Young daughters-in-law would be worked like slaves and rebuked and abused and beaten by mother-in-law at the slightest pretext. When she had a puberty and became young, the mother-in-law would hawk at her, prevent union with the son at all means. Attempts to control her were very primitive and brutal. She would poison her son's ears, make her toil without any respite and food. Knife, you know, unbearing, unable to bear this torture. The girl goes back to the mother's place. She was, you know, coaxed and brought back. And then again, she went away. Then the steps they took were, you know, really horrifying. They were made to, I'll just go pretty fast here. She says that when they came back, they were made to work very hard. And again, if the girl goes, then they would bring her back, and then the mother-in-law would tell, you know, that you chop off her nose. So the physical brutality, I'm telling you, even the nose of the girl was chopped off, and then she was deserted. No one would take her, and only imagine her state. And she describes the state of pregnant mothers suffering at the hands of midwives who had no sense of hygiene. And there were so many deaths due to tetanus. Child mortality was very high. New mothers suffered and survived only if they were lucky. Without proper food, no medicine, no proper care. This saga of, however, through the saga of pain, Kamle narrates. She makes the point that given the opportunity, these very women showed their grit and proved their worth in the Dalit movement by their participation and activism. Sharmila Reje writes, some writers of Dalit autobiography question the relevance of highlighting the past life, which has been neglected by the community. It can be said that Kamle's writing of Dalit history through her autobiography is a way of giving voice to all the silences and misrepresentation of Dalits. For example, the conversion of Ambedkar has been misconstrued as a political and individual decision. Kamle, through a detailed record of the exploitation and oppression of the Dalits, in a way, justifies the mass conversion of the Mehers to Buddhism under the aegis of Ambedkar in 1956 as a conscious decision to refute caste oppression of a religion that didn't care for them. She challenges the devaluation of the labor and servility by pointing out the productivity and utility of their work. Kamle's narrative style challenges the bourgeois genre of autobiography by replacing I with we. The self in the autobiography is both individual and collective. It acquires larger meaning only in the context of narrative of the community because it represents a promising future for the individual and community. The past offers a stepping stone to articulate a new future. So Dalits cannot dismiss their past as a paltry thing. Ambedkar introduced a new narrative of Indian history as Buddhism against Brahmanism. Mahatma Phule saw the history of India as a clash between the aborigines, Shudra, Atishudra, and Aryans. This legacy is carried forward by Kamle, as her autobiography is a critical construction of Dalit history. She not only reconstructs the past lives of Dalits, but her thrust is on Dalit movement, the impact and influence of the dynamic personality of Ambedkar in bringing dignity to their lives. She also laments the selfishness of the Dalits who became educated and started living like the upper caste, also called the Sanskritization of Dalits, without any commitment for the welfare of the community. She writes, Ambedkar had foreseen that the future of Dalits depended upon the educated Dalits. She does her bit for the community and follows the principle of Ambedkar in her life. Instead of seeking jobs, she set up a shop with her husband, and which she ran along with her husband, where she wrote her autobiography as she had a lot of time sitting idle and waiting for customers. In her interview to Maya Pandit, she said that she got books that came along with the newspapers for packing and started reading them. Many contained stories of gods and their great deeds, but these stories made her angry, as she found that they were all wrong. For example, the story of Vrinda, the Shudra princess. Kamle found that these stories mythologized the suppression of the lower caste, so she took up writing with responsibility to present the true picture. She became the member of a library and read many more books and started writing whenever she found the time. She would furiously make notes and hide it away. She filled many notebooks, but she says writing was not easy. She was 30 when she started writing. Her son had started going to school and her husband considered her an ignorant woman. So she was afraid of his response and hid her work. It was only when Maxine Burston, a sociologist working on scheduled caste, came to her to collect data that she shared her story of writing with her. Burston made her read her stories to her. She liked it and got in touch with Vidya Bal, editor of Sri. Her writing was serialized in it, and her son's father-in-law, who was in Pune, happened to read the magazine, got a pleasant surprise. Some people in the family came to know about it, but she was not yet ready to talk about it. Mr. Kulkarni of Man Samman Publishing House offered to publish it as a book. She had to visit him often in Pune, but as her son lived there, she had an excuse to go there, and the book was hence published in 1986. It got a very good response from all quarters, and the painful accounts of women's lives she had written about seemed to reiterate what a Hmong girl in Mahatma Phule school, Muktabai, had written about the state of women 150 years ago in an essay published in 1855. So we can see that way back in 1855 also we had a Dalit woman writing an essay when she was only 14 years of age, and she had only had 3 years of education under Mahatma Phule schooling. Muktabai too had questioned the religion that she had no access to but was expected to follow. In merely 3 years of schooling, she could figure out and wrote this essay at 14, where she sees through the politics of the Brahmins using religion and keeping the monks and mahars without food, shelter, clothing, and education and exploiting them. Kamli and the entire Mahar community converted to Buddhism, but the monks along with the other 11 Balutidars remained Hindus. So now, once again, they were isolated as Buddhists. She continued her social work and ran a school which had 250 students at that time. Baby Kamli herself faced violence in marriage, but she doesn't talk about it in her autobiography because she says in her interview, everyone was undergoing the same thing. Like all women, she would be beaten up at the slightest pretext, but she decided not to quit because her family was good and to her, and she wanted to do good work. The rest of the family was supportive. She also internalized the Pativrata concept as a child when she heard these stories from her uncle. She considered the male ego responsible for this attitude of men. I'm a man, that ego. I'm superior to women. I'm somebody. If the whole village tortures us, we will torture our women. Fathers taught sons to treat their wives as their footwear. However, with education, jobs, and success, they had other places to prove themselves. So things were slowly changing, she believed. She identified herself completely with the community and says that her autobiography is the autobiography of her community. So we find that Kamli doesn't write much about herself in an autobiography, though she gives some details about her births, and she highlights the gravity of the ignorance and lack of medical facilities among the Mahars through it. She speaks of the troubled relationship of her parents, like I said, but she speaks also about her unique marriage to her husband. It is in the interview part. To her husband, like I said, he used to study with her brother, and they used to stay in the same hospital. And what she says is the influence of Ambedkar even in her marriage, which was one of the first of its kind in a minimalist manner without a priest. She got the support and of her family and her people. So she endures the physical violence, which is a testament of patriarchy, that patriarchy continues to be oppressive even after education and comparatively better living conditions. In her interview, she also speaks of rapes that go unreported to save family honor. So I conclude by bringing a summation of the two books of two generations of two ages, Amar Jibon, My Wretched Life, which was supposed to be your translation of Baby Kamli. Anyhow, this is my summation. That Rajsundari gave birth to 12 children, of whom only 5 survived way back. Baby Kamli gives birth to 10 children, of which only 3 survived. Rajsundari hid the pages from which she taught herself. Baby Kamli hid her writings from son and husband for 20 years. She was afraid of her husband. But both do not speak ill of their husbands. Both use images of bird in a cage and bullocks. Rajsundari created and reclaimed her life through her autobiography, in which she fixes the gaze on herself, countering the male gaze that shaped her entire life. Kamli fixes the gaze on a community in which she merges her selfhood. Rajsundari speaks to a personal God and places a faith on him as he is benevolent, though she has complaints conforming to the bhakti tradition. Kamli critiques the religion that made life insufferable for them and places her life and trust in their savior, Baba Sahib Ambedkar. Rajsundari's first autobiography, writer in Bengali language, published in 1876, though at that time, Shornukumari Devi is also publishing her novel. That means, like I said, many other women were being educated in their homes. And we have seen her struggle in educating herself. that speaks about the role of the, you know, men in the family. And we also heard about Mukta Bai Salve, the first Dalit women writer in the 19th century, 1855, her essay was published only through 3 years of education, which shows that women given the chance, or even not even given the chance, as in the case of Rajshankari, what they can achieve. So it shows that given the scope, women cutting across the borders of caste are perceptive and intelligent and prove that they are not meant for housework alone, as was the common belief and is still the common belief in some sections. This has been proven even in the 19th century when the windows of education were being opened. The autobiographies of by high caste women like Rajshankari and much later by Kamala Das in My Story and Rasidi Ticket by Amrita Pritam focus more on the individual emotional aspects. But we find that the autobiographies by women from the Dalit community, like Prisons We Broke or Karuku and many other names, I say, they focus more on the struggles of the community. With this, I come to the end of my presentation. Thank you. Yes, any questions? I hope I was clear in my deliberation. You could follow me. Students,
thank you, ma'am. I am very thankful to Madhu Srivastava, ma'am, in my core of heart. We all are very grateful to ma'am to give us her precious time for this session. Today's session was amazing for me. We learned a lot of things from ma'am. Ma'am discussed many important things like what is autobiography, women's autobiography, types of autobiography, Indian women contribution in autobiography, and many other things. If anyone any queries, please ask ma'am any question. Okay, then now I would like to request everyone say something about today's session.
Thank you for the excellent presentation. It is extremely helpful. I have learned and enjoyed this session. I'd like to thank our distinguished speaker, Madhu Srivastava, for making a very thought-provoking presentation and making this webinar very meaningful and interesting. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you. It was a pleasure being with you all.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a wonderful session.
Welcome.
We have already reached the end of this session.